I'm Frank Conrad, the chief architect of Audience Science. I do a lot of stuff on the large scale. I do it for a very long time. I was co-founder of 7D and Wonderloop. We introduced, for example, header bidding at Wonderloop long time before it was somewhere there, but we have a different name for that. For me, it's all about performance, efficiencies, and scalability. And this is also where I want to talk about today. I try to speed it up a little bit. What is Audience Science? Audience Science is a company who works with advertisers to give them DSP and DMP access that they can do worldwide advertising on the OpenRTB world. And as I said, worldwide, we have five data centers in the world where we connecting to the edge in East Coast, West Coast, Amsterdam, Hong Kong, and Shanghai. And sometimes I say the word was because the company has gone out of business 10 days ago. What is the challenge? What we have here is basically the collection at the edge, because you have to do with advertising, you bid on ad places, you have money on your logging data, because you get notified what is the winning price, because it's price auctions. So you get a lot of data which is billing relevant. You have also a lot of data what is relevant for only reporting and analytics things. You have to get it back from all over the world into the central data center. You need to care about how you do backup and disaster recovery, if your transport is not working, or also if you have some misinterpretation done in your logs that you can replay something and such a thing. You need to do processing, creating the reports, and we are talking today about of increasing the traffic of on 10x and what's happened about. Let us start with the edge. We have there a couple of components up to 1,000 VMs, which produce logging data, as I said, sometimes billing relevant, sometimes not. And as we started with all the stuff in 2011, we start with Scribe. It's a Facebook project to do streaming stuff. Scribe itself is very, very stable. But we run in some scalability issues because you have only one connection between client and server, and over latency lines, this doesn't scale if you get more and more traffic. Then the next approach was, let us compress the files, because Scribe also produce file logging, compress them into rsync, which was a kind of benefit because of the compression, but maintaining all this rsync stuff and getting delayed and have a sufficient amount of parallelism was all a pain in the air. So we basically switched to Kafka, used this, and Kafka was really, really successful. We have a cluster in each of our distributed pods, or how we name it, edge components, what we call pod, and the bidders and ad servers feeding with their standard library, with the standard clients, the data to the central cluster, and there we run Mirror Maker, and with Mirror Maker we copy over it in our DC cluster, where then we have getting all the process, later processing the data. But there are things, even if Kafka really scales and runs rock solid, you have sometimes outages, even if they get introduced by operations or hardware, and you have to figure out what you want to do. in case, especially where you have money log files. And so we introduced basically, we made the decision on our side to do a Kafka fallback. The library supports such a thing, and we basically write it somewhere to the local disk and have then cron jobs to try to feed it again. If you are in a more dynamic environment like Amazon, where a server starts and dies, you have probably to write it to S3 to achieve similar things. The other solution, what was discussed, was basically saying, okay, we stop bidding. If we can't write our money data, we should not spend data. But business said, this is not good, we should go with this other log file solution. And so, so we basically comes to a huge Kafka cluster, and as I said before, Kafka itself scales and performs really, really well. On the hardware, what we had clusters between 6 and 12 servers. Each has 17 terabytes of data and 24 cores, relatively beefy servers. I would not recommend in the future to take such a huge size of disks, because if you have a failure to resync, take a really, really long time. So it's much better to have smaller servers and more of them, because then the recovery is much, much better and faster. And also, we used RAID 10 to minimize the edge cases of that the server goes down because of size. And there we used a mega RAID controller with 1 gigabyte of cache and use them really only for writes and not for reads. Because our typical experience is was that Mirror Maker was so up to date that the data was written to disk but never read from disk. So that was still in the file system cache. Read again from Mirror Maker to copy it on the data center. Mirror Maker itself, you have to also really worried about the CPU if you are using compression, because it needs to decompress the data and compress it again. So you need sufficient amount of CPU resources for that. And you should really think of filtering if you have a lot of topics that you have multiple instances of Mirror Maker. What we have end up in, then we put it in a Docker container and run it in a Mesos cluster, so it's, we also easy can scale it up and down in case on amount what we need. Also important stuff is that your monitor, your Kafka cluster views used for this Kafka manager to get an overview of what's going on, and a lot of Nagios JMX checks to figure out that the Kafka state is in a good place. Then we introduced something very special that we say, okay, we need to do some additional processing on the full incoming load. We had up to 500,000 TPS per second. And we want to do some additional analytics filtering stuff, and but we don't want to do it in the bidder and in the edge components to don't delay them. So we had really to tune the cluster to handle such a load. And the things what you then need to really to consider is the amount of data you want to save and how long you want to take it. So we really reduce it to 2 hours or something like this, that in terms of outage, no resyncing is needed, also the replication. The other piece is the disaster recovery. Thinking about that is basically that you need to do reprocessing or building, have a broken DC. What we have done is basically with C-Core, copy the stuff directly from the edge to S3 as a backup. We're facing there a lot of performance and scalability problems of S3, but we have supplied some patches which get accepted to C-Core to address them, and also two other guys giving us a feedback, it solved their problem as well. And on the DC side, is you can do then basically only periodic backups, even a week or something like this, if you say, I can reprocess a week in terms of a real disaster. I have to go now relatively fast. The central DC, we really started with the classical approach of copy over this with Hadoop tools from the async files with Hadoop tools. This doesn't scale. We use PIC to do all the consolidation things and so on. And it really comes to a lot of performance problems. And so we said we need to really redo this stuff and basically address things like that you can really specify the mappers and reducers to the things what needed, do all the work on the mapper side, which is, I think, the most important stuff for MapReduce, allow combiners, minimize shuffle data. And the other piece was basically really looking to the data, what you have and what you want to have there is to our use case, we created something like what we called baskets, which was basically a bunch of data, which has together, and you can query it. And we before we had the classical design of log lines, and you have the log lines over the time area, and then you query over all the stuff, and we said, okay, because of the use case, you do reporting, a lot of reporting is campaign-related, because you have advertising campaigns, so let us have a basket per campaign, and also say, have in one record all the data for one user. So if a user has multiple impressions, we have this all in one record. This is some nested data, but the nice thing about that is that even frequency things you get for free, because you know they have, you have this user only one time in there. So you can really do everything on a mapper side. And the basket type billing is basically for billing purposes, which is per exchange and timeline and only transaction oriented. So the reason why you can say you can also do it with the other one, no, because it's user oriented and you have sometimes bot user or systems don't behave well, so you can't put every data in it because it gets too big. As a result of this optimization stuff, we get really 6x of 6 times more of performance. The cluster get leveraged much, much better, much more evenly because of the better working things. We could produce 30 reports in parallel. In the past, it was only one. So really, we get a lot out of it. The cons, what was there is basically the store is like a parquet file. Every time you update the data in it, you have to completely rewrite them, which means for us, in a case, we typically apply 1 terabyte of data to it, to a 60 terabyte of active data. And the total data set is more than 160 terabytes, but the rest of the 100 terabytes are not changed typically during the day. These are older campaigns or campaigns which don't get data. And we have this nested data format, which a lot of tools, including Parquet, have some problems. Yeah, it's a non-standard way of thinking. We have get there a lot of feedback in these things. But we do some special, really special things in it. This basket data store, what we have there, we try to get as huge maximum size of files out of it, that we have not so much small files, but but the drawback is HDFS or S3 you're writing to, you can only have one writer, you can't really append to that. So basically, if you want to have parallelism, you have to have multiple files, so you have to partition them. And the things what we have done there is basically we do the partitioning always that we double the size. So every time we go to the next step, each file gets only half of the size, which means that also the campaigns baskets have very similar partitioning. They have all the same ordering. So in terms that you have the same partition size, you can easily join the data. So you don't have to shuffle it. You can do reduce site reading and do stuff. So basically also on the producing, the new store, we only need to on the mapper side to read the incremental data, this 1 terabyte, shuffle it to the right reducer, and the reducer reads directly the old file and merge it. And because of the right order and right partitioning, you can do it in a very stream way, and this gives us a lot more throughput and address the problem that you have to shuffle a huge amount of data. And the other piece that basically saved, because it's a bunch of files, we organize these things as list of files and not directory-wise, which is typically the stuff what you like to do on S3, on HDFS. But you have get a lot of problems with that on S3 if you get huge buckets. And because we have this with files, file lists, we was able to put this easily also on scalable on S3. And yeah, this was also an important part there. And the next piece is the visualization. So we have now all the reports. We produced in the past 96 reports every day, different reports. And we said this is this is not scalable in the future, and also address not the needs of the customers and product. And we need to work with a warehouse and some facts, effect and dimension tables and databases. And so we make the proof of concept with Redshift and Visual Data, and this worked. Let me recap. This with Redshift was not working so well, and also with the visualization tool, we switched to Snowflake, and Snowflake is really a good tool for such a thing because it has a clear separation between storage and compute. So maintenance, performance-wise, the cache is very helpful for all the UI stuff at query, and Looker is a good tool to integrate in your UI, and you can do good breakdowns and custom views for protobufs. Okay, then I will have to shorten because of the time. Thank you, Adam Shepard and Prashant, who helped me out to collect all the stuff. And as I mentioned, Audience Science has slept down. We are all looking for new opportunities. And yeah, this team who has done all the stuff is available in Pune. If somebody needs to extend, give me a note. Thank you.